Welcome to Bad Weapon Academy, where we take the worst weapons TF2 has to offer, and I show you how to best utilize them. Today's episode is going to talk about what many would argue is the worst sniper primary weapon in the game, the Classic. The Classic is a weird weapon. It's directly lifted from Team Fortress Classic, and put straight into TF2. So how does it translate over? Well, it doesn't. I'll be honest, I've never played TFC because $5 is too much for a game I'm probably only going to play one time to see what it's like in comparison to TF2, so maybe the rifle was good in that game. I will never know. But let's look at the stats. You charge your shot by holding down your fire button, and then fire by releasing it. You can do this independently of your scope, meaning that you can fully charge while having a full view of the battlefield, or come out of scope at any time while keeping your charge. As a downside, you do minus 10% damage on body shots, meaning a fully charged body shot only does 135 damage, and you cannot deal critical headshots unless the rifle is fully charged. Let's go over these quickly. Easily the most notable and attractive feature about this rifle, aside from its slick as fuck design, is the fact that you can see the entire battlefield while retaining your charge. As a sniper, you usually get tunnel vision pretty badly. This happens to even the best players. It's hard to focus on everything at once. Well, with the Classic, that's no longer an issue. It's nearly impossible for spies to get the drop on you when you can easily 180 without having to lose your charge or instantly quickscope them. I've also found that it's probably the best sniper rifle for when you're getting spawn camped right outside your door, especially by an overhealed heavy because of this feature. Though this is obviously a rare occurrence. It's a massive upside all around, but it's sadly the only one this weapon has. Well, with one exception. Charging by holding down the mouse button and firing by releasing makes the weapon feel very similar in playstyle to the Huntsman. You can basically think of it as a hitscan Huntsman. This can make it feel very clunky to use though, and it can definitely take some getting used to, especially if you're always trying to go for no scopes. I wouldn't be surprised if most new players who unlocked it for the first time were just really confused and couldn't figure out how it works and just dropped it in favor of their stock rifle. Not that I would exactly blame them for doing that, though. Next up on the stat list is the minus 10% damage on body shots. This doesn't sound like much, but coupled with the next stat, it's pretty crippling. This stat means that even fully charged, you are incapable of one-shotting a medic with a body shot. It does put you above the Huntsman's 120 max body shot damage, meaning that scouts who think it's a bright idea to rush you can get fucked. But it means that medics, your main target aside from other snipers, are much harder to kill. The final stat is the most crippling, the inability to do critical headshot damage unless you're fully charged. This completely changes the way you have to play with this weapon in order to be effective. I saw a video a long time ago about how to effectively use the Beggar's Bazooka, and it basically said to always be loading rockets in, even when your enemies aren't nearby, because you never know when someone is just gonna rush at you with your pants down and run you over. That's basically how you have to play with the Classic. Always be charging. This comes with its own problems, however, as hard scoping in this game is generally ill-advised because... Yeah, that's why. While you are much stronger against spies thanks to your boosted awareness, you are fucked against enemy snipers because you can't quickscope them. Enemy snipers are your biggest target besides medics and your biggest threat. And even a half-decent sniper can make minced meat out of you if you're helplessly out in the open with half charge. There's also a couple other things to mention about this gun. If you thought you'd be smart by hiding behind cover and jumping to shoot, forget about it. This gun is incapable of firing if your feet aren't touching the ground. So if you're jumping, swimming, or get blasted up by an explosive, forget about even firing. Those last two surprise me the most, considering every other rifle in the game is capable of doing those, but not the Classic. I've been in so many situations using this gun where a soldier pops me in the air, and even though I have full charge and a clear shot on him, I can't do anything about it. Also, even though you don't do critical headshot damage upon shooting someone in the head without a full charge, you'll still do full normal damage. So basically, the minus 10% damage penalty doesn't come into effect if you aim for the head. And the last thing about this gun that warrants mentioning is that every single person you kill with it explodes into giblets. This doesn't really affect gameplay, but it makes killing jumping soldiers, brainless pyros, and rushing scouts even more satisfying. Even though it has that 10% damage penalty, this feature makes it feel satisfying and powerful to use as opposed to the other rifles. So what do we make of this gun, and how do we use it effectively? I'm gonna be real for a bit. I really like this weapon. It changes up how you play sniper in a dynamic way that a lot of the other sniper primaries just don't. Do you really play sniper all that differently using the Hitman's Heatmaker or the Bizarre Bargain? Not really. But the classic, for better or worse, completely changes your mindset as you play, and it's a really cool weapon concept. So let's find out how to use it at its most effective. You're going to want to use this weapon where sniper is already the most powerful, at long ranges and around corners. Because you move so slowly while charging, and because you want to be charging as often as possible, this isn't exactly the best offensive sniper rifle. Not to say that it can't be used on offense, I've done it plenty of times, but never to as amazing effect as on defense. If you do want to use it offensively, I'd recommend payload offense as a sort of cart humper. That way, even if you're not getting a lot of kills, you're still helping the team out and you can let the cart push you around, kind of like a heavy. For the most part though, this is a defensive weapon. Now let's talk about your other weapons in order of usefulness. As far as secondaries go, there isn't really a wrong option except the Razorback for obvious reasons, as you're already well equipped to deal with spies yourself. It would only ever be useful in a situation where there's so many spies that you can't keep track of all of them. I'm really not a huge fan of the Danger Shield myself, but if you find yourself in a situation with a lot of pyros, go for it, I guess. Jurati isn't the best with the classic, as you'll need to soak someone, then charge for 3.5 seconds, and hope they're still in your line of sight or haven't killed you in order to get the most out of it. But if you're confident in your abilities to kill people and using it to support your team, it's never a wrong choice. The Cozy Camper can actually work decently well, as you're going to be constantly charging, so you'll be able to benefit from its upsides the most. Though if you're rushed down and miss a shot, you could still be in trouble. This is where my personal favorite picks come in for secondary choice, the SMGs. It's easy to forget about the sniper's SMGs, but I personally find them to be among the most underrated weapons in the game. They're hard to track with, but if you can manage to hit most of your shots, it's nothing to sneeze at and you're far from helpless against even tough close-range classes. The SMGs are the most useful in the most situations with the classic, in my experience. Should you find yourself rushed down having missed a shot or only hit someone with a partial charge, the SMGs are perfect for protecting yourself at close range. Hit someone for 135 but need to finish them off? Use your SMG. You can take care of those pesky medics and gunslinger NGs, even pyros and demomen if you're good enough with your shots, without having to go for a clunky second body shot. It's kind of like using the pistol with the Widowmaker as engineer. You have such a high chance of screwing yourself by missing even one shot, so it's worth it to have a secondary means of doing damage. But we have two SMGs here, the stock SMG and the cleaner's carbine. So which one comes out on top? I'd say they're about equal, as they both have their upsides and drawbacks. The stock SMG obviously puts out more damage, as it fires faster and has 5 more shots. But the carbine has the unique Crikey function, which allows you to do mini crits with all your weapons after doing 100 damage with the weapon. Meaning, if you pair this up with a well-timed classic body shot, you can finally one-shot medics, but the timing on it is extremely precise. You can get off 2 fully charged body shots in the 8 seconds of mini crits you have, so you better make them count. As far as melee goes, it honestly doesn't matter that much. Sniper melees are mostly the same and don't function all that differently. However, special mention should go to probably the two most useful in the bunch. The Shansha is actually pretty useful in a situation where you're getting rushed down by a class chipping away at your health who only needs a single 81 damage swing to take out. And the Bushwhacker is good depending on your secondary of choice. If you use the Jirati or the Carbine, go for it. I just really hate the Bushwhacker, so it's not for me. Otherwise, just go with whatever you feel like. You're just going to be hoping for a random crit with whatever melee you use anyway. Now let's talk tactics. You should be using this weapon primarily on maps that have a lot of corners for you to pop out from behind so you can take pot shots at the enemy team once your charge is full. This can also work at close range if someone is coming at you. Simply back around behind a corner and wait while your charge goes up. The main point is, like, you can consider this the thesis for this entire weapon. Your enemy should not be seeing you unless your charge is full. If they do see you and you've missed them, fall back to your team or whip out the SMG. This is also important. Try to play around your team. They can basically act as meat shields for any spam or gunfire that comes your way. If you have an engineer friend around, try to stick by his side as much as possible while still being close enough to the front lines to get kills in. Go for headshots on targets that you're confident in your ability to hit, but try to think of this weapon as kind of like the Ambassador. Even though it can headshot, you shouldn't always try to headshot every single person you see. Because it takes so long to get a charged up shot going, every shot you take is precious. So if you can only get a kill by body-shotting someone, go for it. This is not a weapon for honorable headshot-only snipers. You take what you can get when you use one of the worst guns in the game. That being said, once you get confident enough in your abilities and start going for more headshots, you'll find yourself hitting a lot of them. I swear to God, I just aim better with this gun because the way you play it makes you treat every shot as a precious resource. A lot can happen in 3.5 seconds, so it forces you to make every shot count. This poking around corners playstyle can easily net you a lot of kills, and your enemies will be ultra pissed off at you. This is one of those weapons that will make your enemies bury their head in their hands and think, "Man, I got killed by that thing?" And don't forget, you can scope in with this weapon. I understand going for fat no-scope headshots is extremely tempting, but we're not talking about how to get into a montage video. We're talking about being as effective as possible. As you're going around a corner, stay out of scope so that you can see the entire battlefield and get a good view of all your potential targets. Once you've isolated your target, then zoom in and take the shot. I've found that this is the most effective way to play Classic Sniper, and I've played a lot of Classic Sniper. Because you're able to pick out your targets more easily, this can actually be pretty effective, though it obviously comes short of the other sniper rifles, except maybe the Sydney Sleeper? I don't know. I'll have to use that weapon a bit more before I come back to it. Maybe it'll get its own episode. Also, I haven't been able to prove this yet, but I have a conspiracy theory that this might actually be the best not banned sniper rifle in the game for holding the last point in sixes. Just because you can see every point of entry the enemy team might try to come in while still keeping your charge. Hopefully I'll get some people to try this out now that I've made this video, but that's about it for the Classic. It's one of the more unique weapons in Sniper's arsenal, which is probably why it's so shit, but that's not going to stop it from being one of my favorite weapons. That only leaves us with the questions of, how should we buff it so that it doesn't need an episode of Bad Weapon Academy anymore? Honestly, I don't think it should be buffed. The entire point of the weapon is that it's a direct rip from TFC into TF2. It is, by definition, a gimmick weapon. And changing it would defeat the gimmick and therefore the entire purpose of the weapon. Would it be nice to get mini crits on not fully charged headshots? Well, sure, but then it wouldn't be the TFC rifle anymore. The only change I would suggest is putting it on the same playing field as the other rifles and letting you fire it while swimming or while popped up by an explosive, because that honestly seems more like a bug than a feature. But that's everything I have to say. Thanks everyone for watching, and good luck fragging out there. Get that no-scope headshot, and tell them that Fish sent you.